The court arrived in Seville on the 3rd of February 1729 and settled in for a stay which was to last 3 years. Spain has two ways of affecting foreigners. It can fascinate and it can be cruel. In the medieval palace of the Alcazar, Scarlatti was exposed to a wholly new sensibility, the inspiration of Moorish art, exotic, sensuous, yet as intricately ornamented as the Baroque idiom in which he had been trained. But for Maria Barbara, all this was merely prelude to the true horror of her situation, a horror carefully kept from prying eyes. To the outer world, her father-in-law was what he once had been. But Philip V of Spain was no longer the promising Prince Scarlatti had met 25 years before in Naples. Spain had broken him. He was now a physical and mental wreck, to all intents and purposes, mad. Kept guarded in solitary seclusion by his queen, Isabella Farnese. She controlled both court and government to serve her personal ambitions. Through bouts of melancholic despair, the king clung to one idea, to abdicate. She deprived him even of a pen with which to do so. She kept him far from Madrid so that government officials could not see him. Meanwhile, she schemed marriages to place her own family in positions of power throughout Europe. Against her domination, he had set up a kind of passive resistance. He would dine at 3 in the morning and retire to bed at noon. For months on end, he would not have his linen changed or his hair cut. Apart from the Queen, the only person to have regular access to him was the royal confessor. In their own part of the palace, the newlyweds incurred the Queen's jealousy. Immediate favourites with the populace, they were refused permission to leave the Alcazar in case they were acclaimed in public. They spent most of their days confined to the palace gardens. Ferdinand was already a fond husband. He hadn't his wife's talents nor her charm of personality, but they found companionship in music. It was a passion they shared. Meanwhile, the music master, who helped provide that solace in their lives, was becoming conscious of the unique heritage of Andalusia. Something dynamic in Scarlatti's nature had never been fully released by the musical conventions he was used to. It responded now to what he heard beyond the walls of the Alcazar. The long stay in Seville, consoling his young charges with concerts in Maria Barbara's rooms, began to kindle in him the Spanish fire that was to blaze up in his sonatas. beyond the actual walls of the Alcazar and the eccentric lifestyle of the court, Scarlatti and his young wife appear to have lived in the town, within the barrio or parish of Santa Cruz. We know Maria Caterina's mother followed her daughter from Rome, and she may already have joined the couple to keep house for them. But our only dated evidence is that Scarlatti's two eldest sons were christened in this church. He named the first one Antonio, after his former pupil, the King of Portugal's brother, and the second Fernando, after his latest one, Maria Barbara's husband. Every few weeks, the court would ponderously sally forth into the countryside, en route for the Sierras, Granada, Cadiz, or some other passing port of call. Scarlatti learnt to know Andalusia well, and these frequent excursions deepened his understanding of its life, its people, and above all, its music. There are melodies in his sonatas whose regional origins are quite specific, and this area of Spain in particular was one he retained emotional and family links with all his life. Apart from its wines, Andalusia was famous throughout Europe for the breeding and training of horses. No princely education was complete without skill in horse management, and the formalized version of it is practiced in the city of Jerez to this day. As an art form, equestrianism reached its height with a regular feature of court life, staging the intricate spectacle called a carousel, a ballet on horseback. There's no reason to suppose a Scarlatti score was ever used for one, but among all the elements of Spanish life that are drawn into his music, that of the dance is constant. After its three-year absence, the court at last trailed north into Castile to resume its normal habitat in and around the seat of government, Madrid. The Spanish capital in those days had an epic reputation for discomfort, freezing in winter, boiling in summer, and notorious for its stench. The royal family lodged on the outskirts, but many of their dependents tried to maintain some relatively permanent base in the city. It wasn't easy. They were mostly foreigners who didn't mix and were more or less ostracized by their Spanish neighbors. Only older monuments like the cathedral or the town hall link the city of Scarlatti's time to the Madrid of today. But there are some traces of its earlier, more typically Spanish flavor in the street where by 1738 he was living. The actual house, on the right, has been totally rebuilt. It is now a store selling office furniture. It remained his home base for the rest of his life, saw him marry a second time when Maria Caterina died, and witnessed the births of 7 more children. The seasonal round of the royal palaces began again, the worst being the Escorial just as winter settled in. Here the appalling cold and damp gave Maria Barbara a chest infection every year. In January, it was off to hunting at El Pardo outside Madrid, followed by spring at Aranjuez, the one cheerful palace on their progress, and yet another removal in June. For the heat of high summer, they retreated to a strange mirage of coolness and peace up in desolate hill country near Segovia. It was an entirely artificial creation, blasted out of the rock to provide the melancholy king with a semblance of France and the happier years of childhood. The huge and barn-like palace called La Granja, or the Grange, was the particular favourite of Queen Isabel. In building it, she had actually managed to challenge Versailles, with even vaster gardens and even higher fountains. But the king derived only fitful satisfaction from the whole hideously expensive enterprise. The fountains, he used to say, had cost him 3 million and given him pleasure for 3 minutes. He was by now a pathetic, paranoid recluse. Affairs of state had ground to a halt, even the queen despaired. But then, in 1737, the greatest singer in Europe, the castrato Carlo Broschi, known to the world as Farinelli, was persuaded to come to La Granja and sing to Philip V. After 2 arias, we are told, the musician who had been tutored by the queen entreated him to rise from his bed, suffer himself to be shaven and dressed, and attend the council. Philip complied, and from that moment his disorder took a favourable turn. Life at court revived. It became almost normal. Calmer, though far from cured, Philip himself lived another 10 years, through all of which Farinelli sang him the same 4 arias every night to soothe him. Queen Isabel returned to plotting power for her sons, while Ferdinand dreaded the day his father might abdicate and the duties of monarchy fall on himself and Maria Barbara. Upon this tortured family, the king now imposed a daily obligation to go hunting with him. It was his ritual antidote to boredom. They would troop out with their guns, and then the game was herded past the royal hides to be mechanically mown down. There was no excitement, no thrill of the chase. That was something which had to be supplied by art. Hunting was one of those aspects of court life Maria Barbara endured as best she could. She had not lost her gentle, patient charm, but her youth had gone, she was getting stout, and she had failed in the first duty of royal wives. She was childless. Without an heir, she and Ferdinand were powerless to counter Queen Isabel's schemes for the line of succession. Scarlatti's music was a relief and an escape from a disappointed life. Maria Barbara had reason to be grateful that Farinelli now exercised such influence at court. A man of exceptional integrity and goodwill, he had befriended her even in the face of Queen Isabel's disapproval. But his ascendancy had eclipsed Scarlatti, and she knew Scarlatti was no less deserving. Just a year after Farinelli's arrival, he received a citation from Maria Barbara's father, King John of Portugal. in view of certain particular reasons presented to me, it ran, I see fit to award to Domingos Escarlatti the cloak of the Order of Santiago. He was henceforward officially a knight, the Cavaliere Scarlatti. His sonatas had never been collected together, and this too Maria Barbara put in hand, having them copied and bound as her personal manuscript edition in what grew over the years to be 15 volumes. These are still our principal source for 496 of his pieces for harpsichord. Scarlatti had modestly disclaimed about the Esercizi, the first 30 to be published. In these compositions, do not expect any profound learning, but rather an ingenious jesting with art. If they should catch your interest, show yourself more human than critical, and thereby increase your own delight. To designate to you the position of the hands, be advised that by D is indicated the right, and by M the left. At last, in 1746, Philip V abdicated. Within a few months, Queen Isabel found herself banished from Madrid, and 3 years later was a widow. For all her scheming, her unloved stepson became undisputed King of Spain. Ferdinand had lived so long in the shadows, he was scarcely more fitted to rule than his father. Like him, he tended to be melancholic and was acutely conscious of inadequacy. Like him also, Ferdinand was much dependent on his queen. And Maria Barbara did not fail him. Together they began the reign of the music lovers. The clouds of gloom and madness lifted. The springtime palace at Aranjuez became the focus of their new regime. And Maria Barbara's personality transformed the whole atmosphere at court. I assure you, wrote one observer, that were she but a private lady, she has so many and so amiable qualities that I should look out for her company. presiding over this renaissance at court, its reigning star and impresario was Farinelli. Voices were heard to grumble that the country was entirely run by opera singers and musicians, but Farinelli did in fact, for the first time ever, put the musical reputation of Spain on a par with any nation in Europe. He also brought eminent painters to Spain, like Amigoni, who designed the frontispiece to Scarlatti's Esercizi. He too helped lighten the tone at Aranjuez with such decorations as those for its new music room. What did it sound like in its own day, perhaps in this room, a Scarlatti sonata? We can only guess. We don't know precisely the instruments he played. Here, an unknown princess is being presented with a German harpsichord made by Hieronymus A. Haas and dated 1740. It has three manuals and is a unique survivor of its time. The expressive possibilities of this instrument must be similar to those of the harpsichord of many voices or registers with which the Queen was once surprised as a gift on her birthday. One intriguing fact about Scarlatti is recorded. The picture hinted at is of the improvident genius, as reckless in practical affairs as he is daring in his art. He was a gambler. From no less a source than Farinelli, we learn that gambling often landed him in debt, but that his debts were often paid by the Queen. He was in his late 60s when there began that amazing surge of inspiration and invention towards which the experience of his whole life had been gathering. He wrote as he had never written before, with a command which was as absolute as it was utterly original. The background to this creative outpouring of his old age was the now non-stop round of spectacular musical activity at Aranjuez. In these years, Farinelli was here, there, and everywhere, mounting operas and concerts, diversified with endless boating parties, hunting parties, and firework parties, all to the accompaniment of music. A fleet of decorated pleasure boats appeared at Aranjuez in 1752. It was Farinelli's latest entertainment for the diversion of the king and queen. Maria Barbara was always the focus of these gatherings. She was only just into her 40s, but for years a chronic sufferer from asthma, she had grown distressingly fat. Curiously, Scarlatti seems to have taken no part in all these festivities masterminded by Farinelli, but the tone and operatic spirit of them are in his music. When summer faded at Aranjuez, the court would return to Madrid. It was now an international centre for opera, but Ferdinand and Maria Barbara were extending their patronage of the arts into other fields as well. The rebuilding of the royal palace was continued in their reign, and though they were never to live in it or see it finished, it stands as a conspicuous memorial to them. In the pageant of Spanish monarchy across its facade, the place of honour above the principal entrance on either side of the great clock is reserved for Ferdinand VI and Maria Barbara. Some of the interior was completed in their lifetime, including the entrance hall and the staircase. But as the decade of the 1750s advanced, it began to raise ghosts from the past and tremors of anxiety about the future. Ferdinand had inherited much of his father's constitution. It was becoming clearer that that might include mental illness. In 1755, like a doom, came news of the great Lisbon earthquake. Refugees had poured into the court at Madrid. The Queen was haunted, too, by the fear of surviving her husband as a childless dowager. He would go to the grim vaults of the Escorial. She would be retired in penury. To prepare them a resting place where they could be buried together, she built the convent church of Santa Barbara. In the palace in Madrid, there still exists this royal pharmacy. The Queen's health was getting steadily worse, and she is known to have treated her almost continual pain with quinine distilled from bark. Scarlatti, too, was growing frail. His only surviving letter suggests that he was confined to his house and writing from a sickbed. His last composition was not to be for the harpsichord, but for the voice, a setting of the Salve Regina. On the 27th of August, 1758, the Queen died. Ferdinand was left to mourn. All business is at a stand, reported the British ambassador. There is a melancholy in the king which nothing can divert. No direction can be given, nor any order issued. He will not be shaved, and walks about without any covering but his shirt. He has not been in bed for 10 nights. He declines lying down because he imagines he shall die when he does so. He kept this up for a year and then died exhausted at the age of 45. In her will, Maria Barbara had left to Scarlatti, my music master who has followed me with great diligence and devotion, 2,000 doubloons and a ring. They came too late. He had died before her on July the 23rd, 1757. What was not to die was the strength and exuberance of his spirit.